Guten Tag, hello. My name is Pete De Vrijer. I'm a professor of performance studies at the University of Alberta. I won't go into all the long details of publications and research. My most recent publication is an edited volume with two colleagues titled Brussels 1900 Vienna, which is on the cultural exchange between Brussels and Vienna around the turn of the century. I'm also a theater director and have traveled internationally with a handful of productions, also, for instance, to Innsbruck. But for a number of years, my focus of research has been now on Africa. I have chapters on the cultural representation of the Rwandan genocide. And my bigger research project is on the figure of Patrice Lumumba. I look at how Patrice Lumumba is represented in a variety of cultural practices, going from, say, songs and music over theater and literature to graffiti and post stamps. This is an interdisciplinary and also cross-cultural project with the purpose of charting Lumumba's impact on both politics as well as his cultural significance. And the title of the entire research project is The Figure of Patrice Lumumba in Cultural Discourse and Practice. Perhaps first a little bit on Patrice Lumumba himself. He became the Prime Minister of Congo at the young age of almost 35 on the first day of independence on June 30, 1960. He was the first, and many will say the only so far, democratically elected leader in the Congo. Yet his tenure was short-lived. Barely 3 months later, after he was sworn in, he was deposed, and a little over 6 months later, he was assassinated together with two of his top ministers by the secessionist government of Katanga, led by Moise Tshombe. That was on January 17, 1961, which was recently commemorated. It's generally accepted and also proven to a certain extent that the Tshombe government acted with impunity through the encouragement, some say the direction, of the Belgian and American administrations. Belgium, meanwhile, has recently apologized for their active role in the deposition of Lumumba, although, again, many will say that hasn't gone quite far enough. I am not a political scientist, and I am also not an historian, and most of the work so far on Lumumba is precisely from those two disciplines. My research is rather on the cultural impact and the cultural significance of the figure of Patrice Lumumba. It really all started with a study of the Irish writer and politician Conor Cruz O'Brien, now many, many years ago. He's a somewhat controversial figure. He was working for the United Nations at the time of the assassination. And in fact, shortly after, he became Dag Hammarskjöld's special representative for Congo. He's a man of many hats, a United Nations official. He later entered Irish politics, became a minister in the Irish government, and also became the editor-in-chief later on of the newspaper The Observer. He was also a writer and a playwright, and I looked in detail at his play Murderous Angels, which is about the Congo. It was written in 1969 and it premiered in 1970. An interesting anecdote with that play is that for the Paris premiere of the play, Joan Littlewood, she's a British director, well known for her musical Oh, What a Lovely War, she wanted a then emerging Nigerian writer in the role of Lumumba, namely Wole Soyinka. He was later awarded the Nobel Prize for Literature in 1986. It was interesting because Wole Soyinka was educated in Accra and in London. He didn't have French at all. And yet there he was in this Paris production of Murderous Angels. So he had to learn his lines by heart. And not only that, not only by heart, by rote really, but not only that, he also had to learn the lines of his fellow actors to which he would be responding also by route. So this was an early manifestation of a multilingual production, something that now in post-traumatic theater, we see quite often. So this brings me to an exciting topic in terms of theater specifically, and that is the question of who gets cast in the role of Patrice Lumumba in these various plays. Obviously, race is a huge criterion. It would be crazy to cast a non-black actor, since Pan-Africanism is probably Lumumba's single most prominent call to action for the emancipation of the African people. But do we cast somebody who looks like Lumumba? Do we make an effort in getting this actor look like Lumumba or not? There's some interesting solutions to this. And this also reminds me of, for instance, the Cameroon artist Samuel Fosso, who is known as the man of a thousand faces. He quite literally impersonates black liberation figures like Martin Luther King, like Lumumba, and he uses makeup, hairdo, costumes, other props, in a sort of homage to the person. And he did the same with Patrice Lumumba, so almost literally becoming this figure. He was prominently featured not so long ago in a MoMA exhibition in New York. There's been a lot of publications on Lumumba, as I said, mostly from history and political science, but also from cultural studies. Recently, a hefty volume came out, published by University of Louvain Press, wonderfully illustrated volume. I have two chapters in there. It's a doorstopper, but 2 kilos heavy. And my ambition is now to complement that with an even more comprehensive study of what has moved and shaken around the figure of Lumumba. I look at all kinds of cultural practice and expression, and I also work multilingually and multiculturally. So obviously I have to surround myself with collaborators. I have access to 4 languages. My most immediate ambition is to publish a volume of poetry. There will be poems in Korean, Russian, Chinese, Dutch, German, French, Lingala, you name it, Arabic. The most famous poet on Lumumba is most likely Langston Hughes. He has 4 poems on Lumumba. So all this hopefully will be collected with the original and with the translation, also with illustrations of paintings on Lumumba, because certainly the largest depository on cultural expression on Lumumba is in paintings, which have been collected to a certain extent, although there's still been paintings being made, and also was exhibited at a famous exhibition at New York's Museum for African Art. Recently, and this is something I want to share here, I made a wonderful discovery, mostly with the help of my research assistant Ming Zhang, and the discovery was about the Lumumba practice in China. Of course, 1961, this was the height of the Cold War, and Lumumba was a prominent figure in the toing and froing of that Cold War and its various parties. There were essentially 3, the non-aligned countries, the East Communist bloc and the West. So in China too, there was a lot of Lumumba performance, a lot of Lumumba cultural expression. There were operas, plays, ballets, musicals, lots of poetry, documentaries. And we discovered material on these things. And for instance, this is an English publication. It's a magazine type. On the musical, The Battle Drums on the Equator. Wonderfully illustrated, gives us a sense of the size of the casts that were involved in this. Obviously the fact that it is in English also gives us an impression of the importance, but also of the propagandistic nature of these engagements. But the most remarkable thing is that these performances, the actors that were involved, were all Chinese. That means that these had to be performed in blackface. And not only blackface, but actually also black skin, because the more skin was exposed, the harder it became to make them look like African characters. So we look at this with very different eyes, but these productions traveled from city to city all over China. Another discovery, for instance, and I can show you many, is this telenovela. This was based on the same musical, and it was with photographs of that production this time with Chinese subtitles of what was happening, thus telling the story. This was published in a very, very popular series of telenovelas or fotonovelas. I think with a run of about 500,000 copies, which perhaps in China may not have been that much, but still. As I said, I want to be complete, and this is not just archival research, because in fact, things are still going on in terms of responses to the Lumumba assassination. A couple of years ago, Belgium finally allowed a small, tiny square in Brussels, the size of a post stamp, really, to be called after Lumumba, for instance. It was the only country in Europe so far that didn't have anything named after Lumumba. There's still novels being written. For instance, this novel here is Tram 83. That's by Fiston Mwanzi Mujila. He's of Congolese descent. He lives in Graz, so there's an Austrian connection there. And of course, this novel is best read again with some knowledge of the Lumumba figure in order to fully understand all the references. Last year, a children's book came out, a youth book, to understand what exactly Patrice Lumumba meant in the history of Africa. And this came out in Paris. So it's a kind of research that is really never finished. And right now I'm starting the preparatory work for a large interactive database that is capable of bringing to the surface all these interactions, connections, impacts, influences, serendipities, what have you, that the figure of Lumumba has had and is still having. And this will be an interactive database, so available online. And I hope to do this with my colleague from Würzburg, Julien Bobineau, who himself has been working so far mostly on Francophone sources of Lumumba. So, ich danke dem Zentrum für Canadian Studies für die Einladung zur Teilnahme dieser Initiative des Canadian Network Spotlight. Wish you all the best and success to all its participants. Who knows, it may also create exciting serendipities of collaboration and outreach. Vielen Dank.